I'm Nabdeep, and the question that we are going to discuss today was asked in Amazon and Microsoft. The question is maximum product subarray. And this is in continuation to the last question that we discussed, maximum subarray sum. So let's go and let's dig deeper into this question. Let me quickly share my screen so that we can discuss this question. So the problem statement that is given to us is that you are given an array of integers and you have to find the maximum product which is associated with one of the subarrays of the given array. So if the array which is given to us is -2, -3, 6, 0 and 10, then the maximum product will be 36. And that will be for the subarray -2, -3 and 6. So to solve this question, one approach that comes to my mind is that we can take into account all the subarrays and find the subarray with the maximum product. That's one approach to solve this question. But that is a naive approach. That's a brute force approach. And it will take order of n square time complexity, which is very bad. Now to improve upon this, I have a few insights. So for example, let's take this array -2, -3, 4, 5, 6, -12. To find the maximum product subarray, I have to carefully analyze. I would have either positive or negative integers. And the count of positive integers doesn't make any difference. The count of a negative integer makes a critical difference. So I can have either odd count or I can have even count. So if I have even count of negative integers, then I can take the product of the complete array. Because when two negative integers combine or they multiply, then I get a positive integer. So when even set of or even number of negative integers would multiply, the product will be a positive integers, right? What will happen if I have odd number of negative integers? So for example, in this given example, I have odd number of negative integers. So one way to solve this question is I can leave the first negative integer and then take the product of the remaining array. And similarly, I can leave the last negative integer and then take the product of the remaining array. There is one problem with this approach. What if we have a zero over here? So let's put zero over here and let's put another number over here. Let's suppose we have kept 50. Now, if I leave -2 and then take the product of the remaining array, this array's product will be zero. Similarly, if I leave -12 and then take the product of the remaining array, the resultant will be again zero. The maximum product is not zero in this case. It is basically, it could be this subarray, I think. This would be the subarray with the maximum product. So this approach is not working. Can we think something on the lines of maximum sum subarray? What we were doing in maximum subarray sum, we were finding the maximum sum subarray ending at any index I. Right? So can we do something similar to this? Let's try to do that. So for example, let's take a similar example. So this is -2, -3, 4, 5, 6. Let's take 0 as well. And let's take -12 as well. Or let's make it 50 over here. One thing that I need to take care of is, I don't just have to take into account maximum product subarray ending at index I. I also have to take into account minimum product subarray, which is ending at index I. Because let's suppose the minimum product subarray, which is ending at any index I, is a large negative. Or if, even if it's a small negative. So let's suppose the maximum product subarray ending at any index I is -6. Right? So this is the minimum product subarray ending at any index I. And let's suppose the next integer is -300. So this -300 can combine with the minimum product subarray and it can form a large positive. So it will give me 1800. So along with the maximum product subarray ending at any index I, I would also take into account minimum product subarray ending at any index I. So I will take into account three values. I would say one value is array of I. Other is maximum product subarray ending at any index I. The keyword is ending at. That's the keyword. So ending at I. And similarly, the minimum product subarray ending at I. Now let's start with the first integer. The first integer is minus 2. So I'll fill minus 2 over here. The array that we are currently seeing is up till over here. So the maximum product subarray, which is ending at 0, would be minus 2 itself, because there is this single integer that we are seeing up till now. And the minimum would also be minus 2. Now let's start with this part. What I would do over here is, I would take into account three factors to find the maximum subarray product ending at any index I. I'll take into account three factors. One is the array of I itself. It may happen that so far I have only come across negative integers, and the alone integer array of I would be more greater. It would be far greater than all the products that I have seen so far. So array of I alone can be one of the factors. So I'll take into account array of I. That's one factor that I'll have. The other thing that I'll take into account is, I'll take the maximum product subarray, which I was going through, which I was coming across so far, and I would multiply it by array of I. So what I'll do is, maximum product subarray ending at index I, and then I'll combine it with array of I, right? And similarly, what I'll do is, one other thing that I'll do is, I'll take into account the minimum subarray product ending at the last index, and I'll multiply it with array of I, right? I'll take into account these three factors. Whatever would be the maximum out of these three would be my maximum. Whatever would be the minimum out of these three would be my minimum, right? So let's try to fill this table, and then let's try to figure out the insights that we get from this question. So this would be minus 3. So in array of I would keep minus 3 over here. So my maximum ending at I would take into account three factors, which is minus 3, then minus 3 and minus 2, which is 6, and then minus 3 and minus 2, which is 6. So maximum out of these three is 6. So my maximum ending at this index would be 6. And my minimum ending, a minimum product subarray ending at index I would be minus 3. Because out of these three, the minimum is minus 3. We have to take into account minimum as well as the maximum. We have to take these things into consideration so that we can solve the whole question. Then let's come over here. This would be 4. The three factors that I'll have would be 4. 4 and 6 would be 24. And 4 and minus 3 would be minus 12. So my maximum would be 24. And my minimum would be minus 12. Let's go ahead. So over here, my answer would be 5. And the three factors that I have would be 5. 5 into 24, which is 120. 5 into minus 12, which is minus 60. Right? So the maximum is 120 over here, and the minimum would be minus 60 over here. Now let's take into account this. So the three factors that I have are 6. 6 into 120, that would be 720. And 6 into minus 60, that would be minus 360. So the maximum over here would be 720. And the minimum out of these three is minus 360. Now here I came across 0. So what I need to do when I come across an array of I which is equivalent to 0. So what I need to do is, I need to keep 0 over here. If I apply the same approach, if I multiply 0 with max so far, then the answer would again be 0. And if I multiply 0 with minimum so far, then also the answer would be 0. Anything multiplied with 0 would be 0. So that means we cannot take into account this 0. So if I don't take this 0 into account, that means I cannot take the results whichever I have got so far. So whatever results that I have got so far becomes null and void over here. As soon as I come across a 0, then I cannot take the subarray that I have taken so far. So I'll have to do a fresh start over here. So I'll keep my maximum so far equal to 1 and the minimum so far equal to 1. And then I'll continue the same approach ahead. Then I'll again do the same thing. In the next element, I'll take 50. 50 multiplied by 1 would be 50. And 50 multiplied by 1 would be 50. I have to again start. The way I started over here, I have to again start it from here. Because as soon as I get a 0, whatever approaches that I have applied becomes null and void. I cannot take zero into account. And in a subarray, if I'm not taking an element in between, then that creates a breakage. I cannot take the results and the insights that I have got so far. I have to start fresh. Right? So this is the approach that we will be using, and it takes into account all the cases. And the maximum that we'll get over here would be the maximum of all the maximum that we have. So the maximum that we have is 720. So our answer would be, the maximum would be 720, right? And if I can show you which is the product, which is the element, which is the subarray, which gives me this product of 720, it would be, let me quickly show you. I think it is combined and it is formed by these two elements. It is combined and it's formed by -2, -3, then 4, then 5, and then 6. These are the five integers that will combine and that will form the maximum product subarray. So since you have understood this part, now let me quickly take you to the pseudocode. So let me quickly go to the pseudocode. So this is the pseudocode for this question. What we have done over here is we have taken an overall maximum and we have given minus infinity to it. We have given the minimum value that an integer can get. Then we have taken minimum at I, which is area of I, area of zero. To begin with, it was equivalent to area of zero, right? So minimum so far is area of zero. Maximum so far is area of zero. Then I'm traversing through the area over here. If I is equal to zero, then my maximum so far would become equal to 1, I'll reset it, and the minimum so far would become equal to 1, I'll reset it, and I'll continue. If it's not the case, if area of I is not equal to 0, I'll take the max so far, and I'll put into a temporary variable. Why I'm doing that, you'll get to know over here. I'm updating my max so far. What I'm doing over here is, I'm updating my max so far. My max so far would be maximum of area of I and area of I into max so far, and area of I into min so far. So as soon as I update my max so far, in the next value, this thing would get an updated value. But I don't want to get updated value of max so far. So that's why I have saved the value of max so far first, and then I have applied this approach. And then I'll do a similar thing to minimum so far. I'll find the minimum of area of I, and the old value or the previous value of max so far and area of I into the value of minimum so far. So this is how I will traverse. And if at any point of time my overall max is beaten by the max so far, then I'll update my overall max. This was that we are going to use for this question, right? There is a small exception to this question. So the approach that we are going to use over here will work only and only if we have a positive or a greater than zero maximum product, right? So let me take you to those test cases where this approach will not work. Yeah. So the test cases for which this approach will not work are those test cases, those arrays with maximum product subarray, either negative, if the maximum product subarray is negative, or if it's equal to zero, then this approach will not work. We are assuming that it would be greater than zero. So these are few test cases that I've already written for you, which will give me either zero or negative maximum product subarray. So these are some of the arrays. So let me quickly apply my approach, and I'll show you where it will not work. So if I fill my table that I had already created for you. So if I quickly form the table. So this is max so far for me, and this is minimum so far for me. Area of I would be zero. This would be resetted to 1 and 1. This again comes out to zero. So I'll reset it to 1 and 1. This comes out to -20. So these would be the results that I have. Again, I have zero. So I'll reset my max so far and minimum so far. Again, I have zero. So I'll reset them again. So what I get from this is that my maximum would be maximum of all the maximum, and the maximum of all the maximum is 1. Now, this is the problem with this case. So we can easily identify and handle such test cases. How do we handle such test cases? We can handle such test cases by the fact that there can be only two approaches. There can be only two end results. There can be only two arrays with which such kind of a answer could come. So those two arrays could be one which contains only negative integers and zeros, right? And between each pair of zeros, there should be only one negative integer. Because if I keep two negative integers in between a pair of two zeros, then these two would combine and give me a large positive number, right? So between each pair of zeros, I would get exactly one negative integer. That's the case when the maximum product subarray would be equal to zero. If I want to find maximum product subarray equivalent to negative, so that would happen only when I have only one integer and that is also negative. So this is only the case, let's suppose I have minus 20 or let's suppose I have minus 40. That is the only case when I'll get maximum product subarray equivalent to negative. Right? So these are the two cases that I have. So if I get a case similar to this, then I should traverse and I should see whether I have a zero or not. If I have a zero, then my maximum product subarray would be equivalent to zero. If I don't have zero, and if I have only one negative integer, then my answer would be equivalent to this negative integer. So this is how you will handle this test case. I hope you have understood this question, right? And I hope you would be able to implement whatever I have taught you and whatever we have discussed into your favorite programming language, right? And I, at the end, I would like to request you to subscribe to our channel and share and like this post. And whatever questions that you have, just put it in the comment section. We would be very happy to answer your questions. Right? Thank you.
For new programming updates and videos, subscribe to Coding Ninjas channel.